Very good morning. Thank you very much. I left Cairo today at 6 o'clock, so you can see I'm half asleep. Well, the subject of this presentation is about the smoke management in underground tunnel. And here we are using a numerical computation technique. The paper is co-authored by one of my students. I'm a professor at Cairo University. I'm also an ASHRAE director at large and a member of the board of directors. A fellow ASHRAE, of course. So, because of the many accidents that happened in tunnels, with cars, fire, so we had started this study a few years ago. And of course, we start by literature review. What happens in a situation like this when we have what we call the clearing, that the flow goes in one direction and the fire can go in the other direction. So we use a computer software, which is called FDS. And in this, we also track the motion of the car in the tunnel. And here we are just showing the pressure. So we would like to prevent the smoke from going the other way of direction. And to do that, we use a ventilation system. This ventilation system can be either using jet fans. Of course, we used, years and years ago, we used to have ducts. If you have a tunnel and you have a duct going through the tunnel, then this duct takes part of the void, and that is difficult to manage the rest of the services in the tunnel. So we have jet fan, we can have also have central fan, we can also have ducts. These are the three different types of ventilation for the tunnels. So we start recently by worldwide by using these jet fans, and that these jet fans will blow the smoke away in order to clear, because when we have a fire, we have to remove the smoke so people can escape. The visibility limit in the space is very important. If the smoke, because the smoke goes up the roof by buoyancy, and then it fills the whole space. When the smoke goes down to less than 80 centimeters from the floor, nobody can escape, and we call it inferno, total loss. So we can use either centrifugal fans or axial fans. This is a literature review here of the previous work published along these lines. Then we start solving these lovely equations. All mechanical engineers, the EinT equation. We teach them in the third year mechanical. And I always tell my students, this equation brings me money. Let me wear a Pierre Cardin suit, because I use the equations to do consultation work as a design in the real life, and that makes money. For example, I did a lot of tunnels. I did also the church, Christ Church in Egypt, where Christ and the baby was Mary went, stayed for a few months. They built the church, and now I did air conditioning the church 2 years ago. It's an honor to do some place like this. We use the equations because we don't know where to put the air conditioning outlets, where to supply the air with the optimum thermal comfort. Anyway, so we solve these equations at various grid loads, and by the solution we can detect and calculate what happens in this tunnel, whether the tunnel has cars. Each car had a megawatt of about 4 megawatt for a small car, 8 megawatt for a larger car. Here I'm just doing a simulation. So we have the location of the fire. This is a fire, 23 megawatt fire, which is a large one. And you have the, you don't have a point here. So we have the, these are the cars in a row, in a tunnel. And we are going to calculate and see how the when the fire happens, we would like to have the safety of the cars, safety of the human being, and also to evacuate the human being outside. So here we have the human beings, and when the fire happens, this is a real simulation. So this is calculated from the equations. Of course, you have to evacuate the smoke first. Then the people will be able to try to travel and go out. All this happens in a very short period of time, and we thought that the evacuation should be less than 180 seconds. Otherwise, it will be another bad situation, inferno. So if you take cross-section of the tunnel, and then you start locating the cars in the tunnel, we have a different, of course, when we solve equations, you will come up and tell me, how am I, can I be sure that your calculations are correct? So we have to do experiments and compare the experiments to the numerical computations. If they match well with an error of 10%, 15%, then the computational techniques are well representing the reality. And that's what we did in the situation. So here you can have, you can see the comparison experiments, not by us, but another scientist, and these are our predictions, and so on. So they match well. Mind you, when you're doing your numerical computations, and I've been doing this for the past 14 years, 4-0, because I had my PhD at Imperial College in London, and that's how I earn my living so far. As a professor, yes, but also as a designer to systems. You can see here you have a difference. You have some discrepancies, but the general trend is the same. So you can have two things. You can have a qualitative agreement or a quantitative agreement. At least we can have the qualitative agreement, shape, performance, behavior. And that's what we need when you are really doing engineering. Here, for example, the heat release rate, temperature against time. So we go now to business. We take a duct, a tunnel, and we put a car, and we have the jet fans, real dimensions in place. And we start calculating, and when you're doing some smoke management, we have to look at the temperature, we look at the visibility, because the fire brigade people, and also the people to escape, they must see it. So we have a parameter which is called visibility. How many meters you can see through. To calculate the visibility, then you calculate the carbon, the smoke, what is the carbon content, and then you can see and calculate the visibility. For her, for example, here we have different cases with different heat release rate. Heat release rate is the amount of heat going out of the fire. It can be a small car, so 4 megawatts, or it can be a bigger car where he will have 29, 67, and 119. So there's a cross-section of the tunnel, and you can see the car and the jets, and these are some of the temperature distribution. Now this is fine, because this is cold here. But after some time, the temperature increases, and here, this is a longitudinal section, after 1 second, 100 seconds, 150 and 300. Why we stop at 300? We can go up as long as we need, but after this, people must be evacuated from the... So this is a comparison, and I forgot to speak about the grid size. We calculate, for example, of course you have an equation, and we discretize, we divide the space into small grid nodes when we calculate the equation. We solve the equation. The more grid nodes, the better your accuracy will be. If it is infinity, it's much better. But we have to stop at some time. Of course, my students would like to stop at 500,000. But of course, I have a stick. And we started, when I was doing my PhD, more than 40 years ago, the largest grid that I can run on a mainframe was 8,000 grid nodes, 20 by 20 by 20. and 1973. My students now, on a PC, we go to 20 million grade. When I designed the air conditioning system for the stadium in Qatar, where they're going to play the football World Cup, I designed two stadiums there, air conditioning, using this technique. We use 20 million grade. So it's a good way of expressing how things look like. It helps us in the design as well. My second presentation today, which will be after lunch, I hope people will not be very sleepy, will be about the air distribution inside a train carriage. Since this is a transportation, I thought train, and we did train, we did airplanes, and we did automobiles, other vehicles. So here we have the different cases. We change the increase rate, and also here we can see the temperature. Here we have the temperature also along the downstream and upstream. And another case. So I'm just here today just to show you what we can do with computation. And the fire brigade people, civil defense, are very interested in this type of calculations because it gives them an idea about if the design is good. Now in the region, I am the chair of the All Arab Countries Code for Energy and for Air Conditioning. So what we do is, if you have a major project, you must do a computational technique for major projects. To prove that you are satisfying the various codes. So the program I'm using, or I'm talking about today, is called FTS, Fire Dynamic Simulator. It's free. You can get downloaded from the website. It's been produced by the laboratories in the US for fire and it can give very good agreement relative to the heat release rate in tunnels. And we also use the same technique for other places like railway stations, metro stations underground. Because for metro stations underground, if a fire occurs, for a reason or another, a cable, a sabotage, whatever, you have a lot of people to evacuate. And would the smoke allow them to travel or not? So it's worthwhile doing studies along these lines. So some of the recommendation is to do further experimentation and to follow the NFPA, that's the National Fire Protection Agency recommendations. So, in the paper I presented very quickly, we studied the effect of people, heat release. We also look at the carbon monoxide concentrations, the effect of heat release rate on the temperature and velocity. We applied this technique for what's being built now. We had six tunnels under Suez Canal, moving from east to west or west to east under the water. And to us, this was new. We don't have tunnels in Egypt that much, and they're wrong. So I was asked by the dean, can you do this? Can you play around with this? So I went away with my students, and after 2 days, we went to them with a movie. Not this one, another one. And they were surprised. I was surprised also that we can calculate, because when you have a computational exercise like this, you take most of the time to set up your boundary conditions, to set up the initial conditions, to try the grid independence, because yes, I'm using 20 million grid nodes at this location, this location, this location. But if I change the location of the grid nodes, the result should not change, right? So you keep on doing this experiment first in order to make sure that the results are meaningful. You also have to make sure of one thing which we call convergence. We are solving the equations. So the equations are solved by trial and error. You assume the velocity 5 at this point, 4 at this point, and so on. Then you calculate the Navier-Stokes equation. There's an error. You go and recalculate, correct, until the residuals or the errors diminish to less than 10 to the power minus 5, for example. So of course, the student will not like this. Sometimes the equation, as you know, you're smiling, the equation will be, the fluctuating diversion. So you have to be patient. But at the end of the day, when you calculate something and the results are meaningful, you feel like, for example, a jet coming, and you can see the jet. We took classes in our universities in the third year mechanical, how the jet expands, right? So when you predict that computationally, and it matches what you think, you hit a goal. Well, I'd like to thank you very much for your patience, and I'll be ready to answer any questions. Thank you.